Good morning, everybody, and welcome to your live sunrise safari here from the western fringes of the Kruger National Park. We're on foot today. Jandre is on camera. He's back from leave. His vast and very impressive calves dwarfing my plover-like legs. Very nice. And we are here live. Over there is Herbert, and he is running security detail, and just beyond him are some elephants. We can hear them not calling, we can hear them breaking sticks. And so I think we'll just go and see if we can have a look. If you're wondering what on earth you're doing here, well, you are on a live safari, like I say, so please talk to us. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, questions@wildearth.tv if you're on the email. Also out today, Brent Leo Smith, the big loud sound. He is being filmed today by David of the luscious brunette locks. Excuse me. They are driving somewhere around there looking for big cats. Now let's see if we can get a view of these elephants. The idea behind the walking safari is not so much to view the big stuff. We do if we can, but obviously the views you're going to get on foot of the big things are not nearly as good as you're going to get in the vehicle. But it's still very exciting to go stalking up on big animals. Gives a little bit of a thrill. Just going to check the wind. This is not purely for effect, I promise everyone. There is actually a reason for that. There you can see the wind is good for us. Elephants over there, so the wind is blowing from them towards us. So let's just wander through here. And I can just hear a little bit of cracking. Herbert is just in front of us there, and he's telling us where he thinks we should go. And as I explained last time, there they are. We're just going to move a little bit closer, and we're not going to get close, everyone, but we just want to get you a view. Yeah, you're right, and you check in. There. Can you see them there, Andre? You see just a slight grey shape there. See that? Okay, come. That animal is no more than 40 metres from us. Okay, everybody, I'm going to start whispering, so be very quiet. They're just up ahead here, feeding through the woodland. The idea is we try and walk as quietly as possible. Very difficult, of course, if you have the calves of Jandre. It's like having 2 20-kilogram dumbbells strapped below your knees. Jandre, walk more quietly. I'm just telling Herbie where there's one. There's an elephant quite close by here. Okay, here we'll get a view. They really are quite close, they're only about 30 metres away, 120 feet or so. Down. Right. Okay. Look at the Dangane Shidulwe. I'm just asking Herbie where he thinks we should go. Okay. Come with me, we're going to use this termite mound as cover. We're going to walk around here. I think just come with us here. I think we're going to get a view here. If we don't get one round this termite mound, then we'll go to Brent. Jandre, just watch up here. Now, like I say, the idea is not to get close. The idea is not to get close and frighten the animal, or frighten us, more importantly. Wait. Okay, come straight. The idea is just to get you a view and a sense of what it is like to see an elephant on foot. Okay, here we go. We'll get you a view here. You can just see them there. You see them, Jandre? Like I said, won't be a great view. You see them feeding there? We're just going to stay here, everybody. That's kind of the best view we're going to get on foot now. We're not going to try and get any closer than that now. We'll just sit here for a little while and see if they come into the open. While we do that, I think a good idea for you to go and get an introduction from the brutally loud sound and David. We're going to wait here and see what the elephants do.
Good morning and welcome to Safari Live. My name is Brent Leo Smith, or as James Henry calls me, the brutally loud sound. Now, I am convinced, so when I went on leave, I had one glove of each. I'm convinced James Henry is hiding the other of each glove. So again, I have mismatching gloves. I have a mitt and a fishing glove, and I'm convinced James Henry is hiding that and my hat. So I've actually stolen David's hat, the cameraman's hat. As you can see, the cameramen sweat a lot, but I cannot find any of my stuff, and I'm convinced that James has taken great pleasure while I've been away to hide all my different paraphernalia in different places. So it's going to take me a few days to find everything, but welcome to a very chilly Juma private game reserve. It's about 12 degrees Celsius, which is 50-something Fahrenheit, and thanks for the updates about the lioness at the Juma cam with the cubs. How exciting! But there are still guests there, so we cannot go in front of the lodge. So I'm doing a big, wide loop. Just to let you know, Karula was also seen after drive yesterday, but she got chased by elephants, so she could have gone anywhere. So we are checking for her tracks, but first and foremost, I am checking for the Nkuhuma and the cubs. Very exciting. So going very slowly, making sure they haven't crossed north. I think they're probably in this river system off to the right here, but it is very, very exciting. And remember, we are on a live African safari, and you can ask me questions, believe it or not, and you can do that by sending me an email at questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And I am so excited to be out after that gusting, cold, windy evening we had last night. Well, the clouds are coming back slowly, but it is perfectly still. And it is just one of those mornings you're just so excited to be out in the bush. And so far we've only got hyena tracks. So we're going to check Mvubu Road. Now, apparently Mvubu Road is where the hyenas are as well. And that's a bit dangerous for that Nkuma lioness. But we're going to keep checking here, and while we do that, James, being the smallest creature in the bush, is on foot with the biggest creature in the bush.
What is so wonderful about Brent Leo Smith's insults is that they are so deeply original, and I've never heard them before. I'm being entirely sarcastic. This is a wonderful sighting, everybody. We're standing on the termite mound, just looking into the woodland, and I know it's not the best view of elephants you've ever had, but I want you to try and appreciate what it's like to see them on foot. We are standing on the raised sort of castle of clay built by the termites, and we can hear them, we can smell them. They can't smell us because the wind is perfectly in our favor. But look, there's an element of it's not fear, but there's definitely an elephant of thump, 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 where it's just slightly, you've got an elevated heart rate, and this is the most connected you will ever feel with the wilderness, to be standing in a place like this, looking at elephants, knowing that they don't know we're here. That, to me, is the crucial part of this. Now, Dave, you say, what's the story with the wind, and is it crucial? Or is there ever a time that the animals would want to be upwind of us, or we'd want them? No, it's not. Always you want the wind to be blowing from the animal to you, not the other way around. And the key thing also when you're in a situation like this is to make sure that while you're focused on the elephants over there, you're not missing the buffalo sneaking up behind you. There isn't a buffalo now. I'm just making the observation. That's why Herbert is so crucially important to what we do here. While I am focused on the lens and the elephants, Herbert is constantly looking around, seeing what's going on. This is a perfect view of a herd of elephants. Now, what we would do is move away as soon as they became aware of us. Our elephant herds are by nature probably going to be slightly more threatened than elephant bulls because they have the youngsters with us. And Nathan, you want to know if I've had any experience of being charged by elephants on foot? I've had to stand on one or two charges, yeah, but my approach to elephants is such that I generally try and avoid them, or avoid them becoming aware of me. And if you do that, you're generally okay. And you also, if they were to become aware of us now, so if they were to hear my voice, and it wouldn't surprise me from this distance if they did hear my voice, they'd look up and smell, and if we melted into the bush, there'd be no problem. If we stood up on this termite mound and started making a big noise, their response would be one of two things. One, they'd move away, and the other would be that they would come towards us, or the matriarch would detach from the herd and come towards us. And you do hear horrible stories of that. And you know, 9 times out of 10 they'll move away. There's that 1 time out of 10 that you want to avoid, mainly because why do you want them to feel threatened? And so I've seen videos and I've been in experiences where people will walk out in front of the elephants and wave a stick or shout at them and kind of make out that the, you know, show how brave they are by chasing the elephants away. I would consider this walk a failure if these elephants became aware of us standing here, because they're peacefully feeding across here. We know they see us as predators. We know they see us as a threat. And so to make them aware of us, to threaten them in that way, would just be very unkind. We're going to try and get one more view of them, probably from around the other side of the mound. While we do that, we're going to move very slowly. Let's get an update from Brent.
So we're searching for any tracks of that Inkahuma lioness and her cubs. Now, of course, I have not seen the cubs yet, which is very exciting. And I'm hoping we do find some tracks. And I was so excited when I heard there were cubs around. I forgot to mention, Dangerous Dave is on camera. And there's Kirsten and Geraldine in final control. And it is so wonderfully still, and if we just sit and listen to the bush around us, there's only one bird we can hear calling at the moment, and it's quite often the last and first bird you hear in the morning, and it's James's favorite bird, strange enough. Oh, now we can hear a second bird. Oh, there's lots of noise in my ear. There's a white-browed scrub robin. And we can hear a grey go-away bird. Now that is an alarm call. I'm just going to take my earpiece out for a second. So, if you've been in the bush a long time, alarm calls of different birds not only give away the presence of predatory birds, but quite often give away the presence of predators. So if a grey go-away bird alarms at a bird, it's very, very different. Now, when the go-away bird actually says, go-away, go-away, that's generally for a predator. And but it's kept quiet. If we could actually see lion or leopard, it would keep going, keep going. I've just heard that the tracks of that lioness are heading south. Just listening to the game drive radio. Okay, so I've heard Aubrey's got lion tracks around Gallagher. Taxon's now got them heading south. So we're going to keep checking slowly here, because we've got to remember, it's not only the female and the cubs that were around last night. We had the Amber Eyes and that Birmingham boy, and poor old Amber Eyes was just trying to get away from him and his advances. So they could literally be, oh, That is not a good noise. Not a good noise at all. Now, apparently this all started when James ran over a stump. But let's go have a quick look in the bonnet. And while I do that, let's go see what James is up to on foot. Otherwise, I think Dave and I might be walking home.
We haven't moved, everybody. We looked around the other side of the termite mound, and this is still the best view. I think there are upward of 20 elephants here. They've been walking round through the background. You've got the little one there in shot, and that same two sub-adults that we first saw that are feeding to the left of your picture now haven't moved. They're destroying what's known as a Dicrostachys bush or sickle bush. Very good elephant forage. And in areas, in this particular area especially, if you don't have elephants, those sickle bushes become horrible encroachers, and they form these thick monospecific stands of utterly impenetrable bush. And elephants, you can see, therefore, are a completely crucial part of keeping the vegetation in a state where the grazers are able to use it. I think that's the one Jandro is on now. I obviously can't see exactly what Jandro is filming. He's whispering to me, yes, that's the one he's on. Now, when I started guiding, the idea was that we didn't view elephant herds on foot. We only looked at bulls. And that was because the females can become that much more threatened, that much more easily. And that's why, this was specifically with guests, and that's why we're very careful around these ones. And these days you can do it a lot more safely than you could when I started 20 years ago. Not quite 20 years ago, 16 years ago. Because the elephants have become just that much more confiding. They've become that much less threatened by us. Especially since the stopping of the culling in 1996. This is just a fantastic shot of that little one there, learning to feed with his trunk. He's probably about, I don't know, 3 or 4 years old, I'd say. And the trunk is now fully functional, but not quite as strong as it will be one day. And Kathy, you say, do elephants talk to each other while they eat? You're in Washington State. Lovely to hear from you from there. Thank you. You say, do elephants talk to each other while they eat? Can we hear them rumbling? Kathy, no, because that infrasonic rumbling is often of a frequency too low for us to hear. So I've no doubt they are talking to each other, especially the cows and the calves, but we can't hear it. We can only really hear it when they make a very loud and seemingly almost alarmed call. So when they make that, it's often a kind of alarm call. Not an alarm call, but it's a kind of stressful, let's get out of here, kind of a noise. I have no doubt that they're talking to each other as we speak. And remember, animals out here speak in ways that we don't really understand quite often. You know, I think that they often speak in this kind of extrasensory way. They communicate with body language from a distance. They communicate with olfactory senses, hugely importantly, much more so than with us. That's your nose, by the way, olfactory. I'm just explaining for Jandro, because he's from Cape Town and so his brain doesn't work anymore. Used to be from Johannesburg, of course. And sorry. And so, while they're not always rumbling at each other, I have no doubt that they're in constant communication. Now, that baby one, are you on the baby, Jandro? Okay, the baby one there, I wonder if that isn't a slightly bigger version, a year older, of Wrinkly Bottom. Because Wrinkly Bottom had a wrinkly bottom like that one does. And he seems to be almost standing on his back legs to fetch things out of that tree. Well, that could well be him. And it would explain why his herd is so relaxed. They are a relaxed herd of elephants normally. This is just brilliant. I can't tell you the feeling that this brings people. Being so close, feeling the earth under our feet. And the sounds of the elephants. Alright, the elephants are now coming around to the right-hand side of your picture. Oh, Nyala. Look at the Nyala. Isn't that cool? There's a Nyala. It's definitely seen us, doesn't care. Red, you want to know if the baby elephants feel pain when their tusks come out. I don't know, Red. I'm going to assume, yes, probably a bit of teething pain. Remember, you know, the kind of pain that human beings feel when they teethe, I think is, it might be slightly unusual, especially given how underdeveloped human being babies are compared with others. And they just can't cope with pain, obviously, they're tiny little things. Elephant is 18 months to 2 years when its tusks erupt. I'm sure there's an element of pain behind it, but it's not debilitating. They don't get endlessly sick and require teething rings and various other interventions for them to produce their teeth. But I'm sure there's an element of pain, yeah. I don't know that they have a temperature like young kids do. All right, let's go back and see what Brent's doing. We're going to back down off this termite mound and we're going to head off through quarantine clearings and see if we can't pick up tracks of the great queen, Karula.
So, crisis averted. And how did we fix it? Where is it, Dev?
There we are.
There we go. This is how we fixed the crisis. Duct tape or gaffer tape in the film industry it's called. So the great clunking noise was actually created by the stand that we used to hold the bonnet up. And what happened is the little clip that holds the stand in place is broken. So it fell down and hit the fan, and that was like dang, 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 dang. I was actually quite worried. I thought that, oh my goodness, this sounds like the car has died. But we managed to fix it with a bit of gaffer tape. Now, taxons followed tracks of that lioness, and she's gone down into the river system here, so we're going to do the same. There's a little sneaky road, a two-track as we like to call them, that takes us down into the river system. Now, there's a strong possibility she's moved her den site for the cubs from Inyala Road North into the Mawati. So we're going to go, where's the little sneaky road? Unfortunately, it's there it is. It's a bit harder to see these days since the elephants pushed down a tree across our normal access. Oh, look on the ground. You see it there? So zoom, there we go. Look at that. Not a bird you often catch out in the open. And I think our birders will be quite excited. So I did get asked by Safari Dean for a hard quiz. So I think we'll start off a bit easy, and I'm quite sure a lot of our avid birders will be able to identify that bird in two shakes of a lamb's tail. But so what bird is that? It is normally what you call a skulker. And when I say a skulker, it skulks in bushes, and it's not very often we find it out in the open running around on the ground. He's in it. Come on, out into the open again. Yes, oh, it's so pretty. And so it's hunting for insects. And if we look very carefully, you can see there's actually a little curve to the bill, which lets us know its family, although its name is not like the rest of its family, but it is a member. Of the shrike family. Oh, I've got something in my ear. No, stay on the bird, Dave. So Aubrey's just picked up tracks of the female and the cubs going east. And I'm going to ask him now where it is in a second, but I mean, it's not often we get such an amazing view of this particular bird species. Oh, did he catch something? Yeah, he's got something. Oh, and down the gullet it goes. So I'm very, very excited to see who's going to be the first to identify this little member of the shrike family. Dino would like to know whether it's a cinnamon bun. It's not a cinnamon. Oh, sorry, guys. I just need to listen to this. There's quite a few birds around. So while Dave takes you on a tour around, I just need to be on the radio for a second. Tax. Can I take a standby for that position? Copy, thanks. I'm at Gari, Cutline and Central Junction. So, very exciting. Aubrey has found the Nkuma and the three cubs. And we're on first standby, so we're not in a rush. But look right in front of the vehicle here, Dave, in this there. Can you see them this way? Are they too close? No, there. Right there. Look at that, little blue wax bills frolicking around, looking for tiny little insects, or mostly looking for grass seed. Now, well done to Joanne, who has got that initial bird correct. It is the black-crowned chagra. So very well done, Joanne. We get two species of chagra in this part of the world, and we get the black crowned and the brown crowned. So Joanne was first, but lots of you have guessed correctly, and we're going to have a quick look. Ooh, chase it, catch it. They are just so sweet. The powder blue puffs is how I think of them. And the little blue wax balls. Oh, nice big grass seed. Actually eating a bit of Erogrostis there. Erogrostis is love grass. After Eros. I can't remember where it's the I think it's the Roman or Greek goddess of love. And that's where that grass gets its name, because the seeds are shaped like a heart. It could be Roman, according to Kirsten in Final Control. I'm a bit lax on my Roman and Greek mythology. Okay, so we're going to start moving now. We'll leave the little wax bulls to eat their love grass. But so there we go. There's the black crowned chagra. And that's the one we saw on the ground. And we hear, but don't see as often. Oh no, apparently it was Greek. Is the brown crowned chagra, and they are great skulkers. So it's very unusual to see them nice and out in the open, like we just did. Ooh. Do you hear that, Dev? Ooh. I can hear a Varroa eagle owl, and I think I know exactly which tree it's in. Now, they like to roost in very big trees, and jackalberries being one of their favorites, and there's a massive jackalberry just here, and that sounds like it's coming from that exact jackalberry. Now, one of my favorite memories as a child in Botswana is this massive black maned male lion walking through the Okavango floodplains in the level of mist, and in the background you've got the Varroa eagle. Ooh. standing by orbs. Copy orbs. Confirm best access is still from central. Copy, thanks. So there's the big jackalberry. Now, we're going to have to come back. I'm 98% sure that that eagle owl is there somewhere, but the Nkuma and the cubs are about to go into a very thick area, so Aubrey's just called us in. So I will promise for the birders, I'm going to come back and look for that owl. But for the big cat lovers, let's go find some baby cats. So while we race, let's go to a more sedate pace with James on foot.
Now, if you're a predator, of course, what you'll often do is roll about in the dung of another animal. And that, of course, masks your scent. I am not going to roll in this dung, but I am lying in it in order to show you how committed I am to the cause of remaining undetected by the animals around which we are going to be sneaking today. I don't believe I just did this, actually. In Jandro's case, of course, he doesn't need to do this. Jandro, did you wash your hair on leave? No, he didn't. It's actually so... I can't tell you how nice this stuff smells. You know, I'm not going to roll in it. Normally what happens is a predator will go and lie down, often in buffalo dung, which is wet and disgusting, and they'll roll about in that, and then they smell like buffalo dung as opposed to nasty lion or leopard. And if you happen to be a nyala or an impala or a bushbuck or a steenbok or a duiker, you won't pick up on the fact that you're about to be devoured by a sort of shadow that smells like buffalo dung. Let's move on. Herbert is watching this lot going, those people are off their heads. Oh, Shamsung, you say we see many trees that have fallen over, and you're wondering how many of that is, or how much of that is due to termites rather than elephants. It's almost exclusively due to elephants. Well, let's take a look at this tree here. Come, Jandro. This tree here, okay, is now being eaten by termites. Here's their little mound. Fungus-growing termite, Macrotermes natalensis. But it was unquestionably pushed over by elephants. Now, the elephants have opened up a whole ecosystem here for other animals to live in. We've got bracket fungus at the bottom of my stick here, Jandro. That's a fungus there. The only reason that fungus is able to grow where it is because the bark has been torn off here. And the bark was initially torn off, if you come to the right there, Jandri, by elephants. This would have been torn off by elephants. That would have opened it up for wood-boring beetles. You can see they've bored into the wood there. Or possibly a carpenter bee. They will also dig into the wood and also... woodpeckers and things, but I think this has happened post-mortem, as it were, after the tree was pushed over. And so this was definitely pushed over by elephants. The termites have then come into it. They've got into it. Remember, the bark is an exceptionally important covering for trees, and the bark protects it from fire, it protects it from termites, it protects it from wood-boring beetles and their larvae and that sort of thing. Once the bark goes, of course, quickly go over to Brent and have a look at these special things.
So guys, look at this. Thanks to Aubrey, the Nkuma lioness, and the three little cubs. Oh, look at that, this is so exciting. This is the first time I've seen them. Oh my goodness, they are adorable. So we're just gonna move forward a little bit so the other cars can also see. And I'm just gonna stop and let her walk towards us with those three glorious little babies. Now, she is about to go into a very thick area, and she's about to drop down into the drainage line. I can't help myself. If you hear many, many clicks, it's my camera. And I hope you guys are getting screenshots of these incredible little babies. Look at that. Oh, she's just... I need to change all my settings from last night. Now, I know one thing James and I agree on, that little lion cubs are possibly the cutest thing in the world. You lazy lion. Look at them, aren't they just cute? Well done, Mom. They are just absolutely amazing little creatures. At the moment, they're about the size of a domestic house cat. Look at that, she's gonna walk right between the Juma vehicles. Look at them, off they go. Oh, I didn't even manage to snap a shot. But she's about to go into the river system. Now, strangely enough, she's heading into the same river system where I saw Karula's cubs when they were a few hours old. Now, of course, me being me, I have one or two tricks up my sleeve. And one of the beautiful things about not being in Maggie the Mahindra is we're a little bit more maneuverable. So I think I can get a car into this river system. Can you see them through there, Dave? You see them? No. Okay, we're gonna just pop past. I'm just trying to figure out where we are, where's the big tree, how to get into the river here. And isn't this absolutely exciting? In Kahuma cubs, my first sighting. And so I'm going to get into this riverbed, and while I do that, and of course I'm going to leave Dave attached to a thorn tree on my way through, let's go across to James, who's got a beautiful sunrise.
I'd love to say that I have a beautiful sunrise shot, everybody. Actually, Gendre and his very artistic eye have spotted an unbelievable amount of, what would we call those? We would call them crepuscular rays, wouldn't we? Now, the interesting thing is that they are obviously, they don't look parallel, do they? They look like they're coming from one point in the sky. And what is interesting is that they are actually parallel. They are precisely parallel. And the reason they look like that is for the same reason that two parallel railway lines look like they're converging in the distance. So if you watch two parallel railway lines and you're on a straight railway line, you know they're parallel. You know that they don't actually meet. But as they go towards the horizon, you see them meeting up. That's exactly the case with these things here, and that's why always with these crepuscular rays, whether they're coming from the western horizon, the eastern horizon, or this one looks like from straight above, that's just the angle of the clouds to make it look like that, they're completely parallel. And those that are still subscribed to the idea that the Earth is flat will tell you that, or that the Sun is actually much closer to us than we have been led to believe by conspiracy, the keepers of the knowledge, shall we say, the Illuminati of the world. They'll tell you that the sun is actually like a lamp shining over the earth, and it's proved by the fact that these lines are not parallel. In actual fact, they are completely parallel. So if you happen to be slightly dissuaded or slightly doubtful that the earth is round and that the sun is quite a long way away from us, be not dissuaded any longer. Isn't that a stunning, stunning view? Great big slices of golden sunlight dropping down to the earth. I'd love to say that that was my my words, but I stole them from a book I read, I'm afraid. Great slices of golden sunlight. Stunning. All right, we're going to turn around. Herbie's just up here. I'm not entirely sure. Oh, there he is. And we're walking along where we think maybe Karula went. We haven't found any of her tracks yet. Herbert is currently fossicking underneath a log to see if he can find us a scorpion or a millipede or a centipede or maybe even a snake. Let's see what he's found. Of course, the great joy of walking with Herbert is, well, apart from the fact that you feel safe, you learn a huge amount about the medicinal and local uses of plants out here. So hopefully we'll do a few more of those today. I'll go on to... Okay, nothing here. Justin, you want to know if there are edible fungi here? Yes, there are, and you want to know if what their names are. I'm going to be facetious now. Their names are mushrooms. Justin, that's a very facetious answer. There are many different kinds of mushrooms that you can eat, in much the same way as there are in other parts of the world. I don't know any of their names. I know that there's some poisonous ones. I know one or two of their names, but the edible ones I don't know the names of, but there are lots that you can find. Especially in the part of the world where the only ones I've ever eaten wild here come from a part of the world where genre is quite closely associated, and that's a place called Stellenbosch. And you find them there in the exotic poplar plantations. You'll find lots of wild mushrooms there that are very delicious to eat. We're walking through a very, very pleasant woodland that would be very nervous to do in summer because it would be quite thick, but you can see how it's really opening up around us as the leaves fall. And I always think that, and I might be wrong here, having not experienced too many Northern Hemisphere winters, that the trees here lose their leaves relatively late because come the middle of winter, I mean, we're now going towards, we're in midwinter. You would imagine that all of the leaves would already not have their leaves on them. And certainly in Johannesburg that's the case. But here, they maintain their leaves till probably about August, and then the winds come and blow them off. And then September and October is when it looks like a very wintry landscape, although the temperature goes up. I always think that's quite interesting. Let's see what else Herbie's got here for us. Basically turning over every dry log to see if we can find something underneath it. In the meantime, Chandra, she tripped over this little stick here, everybody. This is the only stick within how did you even hit that? Chandra, of course, is the most more accident-prone person I've ever met in my life. Please don't stand on another rusty nail, hoppy pus foot. Now, this is the silver cluster leaf tree. And the silver cluster leaf tree is a very important source of forage at this time of the year. You don't have to come under here. I'll bring it to you, Jean-Marie. Fussy boots. Very important source of forage this time of the year. During the summer months, you won't find much eating this at all, but now, with there being not much else to eat, just listening, you will find lots of animals eating this. And you can make quite a nice string out of the bark. You peel it off. In fact, Herbert is the one who should be doing this, but I'll try and show you how to do it. While I do this, Paperboy Johnny, you want to know about... there we go. Look at that, I didn't even need my knife, I just took it out to show you how manly I am. Paperboy Johnny, you want to know about what snakes we get here, and, we get lots and lots of different kinds of snakes here. The most obvious ones are the ones you would have heard of, were the dreadfully terrifying black mamba, and they, of course, are found here in fairly great profusion. Then you get something called a... puff adder. They're the most commonly seen snakes because they're a bit lazy. They're like lions. And then we get lots of other things. Tree snakes, which is the most toxic snake or poisonous snake in Africa. Venomous snake in Africa. Then we get, what else do we get? African rock pythons, beautiful kinds of snakes. Then we get things like yellow-bellied sand snakes and striped-bellied sand snakes. I'm just running through them as I try and make my rope here for you. I know what's going to happen here is Herbert is going to arrive. and take over from me and embarrass me horribly. Right, there we are. So you take three strands like that, okay? And this is a particularly good tree for it. And then you plait them together. Now, I don't know how many of you can plait. Can you plait, Chandra? You should be able to, given your hair. Tie them in a knot at the end, like that. Okay, I'll make you a little bracelet, Chandra, shall I? Like Herbert made for Jamie the other day and didn't make me one. And then we plait them together. One for one. Oh, no, I've only got two strands suddenly. It's going to look so terrible. Wait, everyone. I will get there. Brent is still repositioning. Thank you, Irette. As you say, are all South Africans this kooky, or am I just a unicorn of humanity? Brian? Herbert has said something. I didn't quite catch it. I think you'll find that quite a few South Africans are quite kooky in some ways. I think you might find that I'm slightly more eccentric than most. Chandra thinks, yes, I'm definitely much more eccentric than most South Africans would be. I don't think I come out of the draw of normality, no. I'm very happy that you think I'm like a unicorn. Some would say I'm much more like a less pleasant rarity in life, but I'm very happy to be a unicorn, Iratus. Thank you so much. All right, here we go. We've almost got some rope here, Chandra. Almost got a piece of rope long enough to use as a tow rope. Now, in somebody else's competent hands, everyone, this would be quite impressive. But you see how I'm plaiting, Chandra. You see how competent I am plaiting. I will not touch your hair. I will not touch your hair without a valid tetanus shot. Now, there's the rope. You see? It's not very neat, but it is actually quite effective. And that is the silver cluster leaf tree, and it's quite an effective rope-making tree. I'm quite impressed with myself there. Thought of that off the cuff there, Chandra. There we go. Okay, come on then, everybody. While Brent is still trying to negotiate his way into a very thick drainage line, if anyone's going to get a car in there, Brent will. Whether he'll get it out again or not is another matter entirely. But with any luck, he'll get it in there and you'll have a nice view of those lions. Now, we just need to find Herbert and find out where he's gone. Because I suspect he's found something. I heard a grunt from the bushes. I hope that wasn't a grunt of distress. I don't think it was. Now, what you do here is you look around. When you don't see him, you go... and then you get a reply. On we go. Now, Brent is still looking for the lions, but go and get an update from him. We'll try and find Herbert, and we'll catch up with you just now.
So we're very confident that lioness has come into this area. If we have a look around us, it's ideal for cubs. And you can see there's lots of little, there we go, little holes and drainage lines. It's a great place for her to keep the cubs. I think she's in these quarry thickets ahead. We've checked that no tracks have come past. So we're gonna give it a quick squiz. And if we have no luck here, there's tracks of Karula to follow next. And they're heading down Central Road to the east. So what we wanna do here is wherever I find a little bit of open ground like this, I'm just making sure there are no lion tracks, and there aren't, which is good. Okay, I just got to be on the Game Drive channel. Okay, so Aubrey's found her. I think he's just to the north of us. I know exactly where she is. Okay. Dave,
yep.
Don't get caught in the thorn tree. I'll try to keep Dave out of the thorns. I can't guarantee. I'm just going to push this quarry a little bit so I can... Ooh. How rude. And there we go. We can get past it now. Just got to be on the game drive for a second. Ah, there's Aubrey. I don't need to be on the game drive. I found him. So she's right here somewhere. Now, this is ideal spot for her to leave the cubs. I'm just gonna... there's Aubrey, so she's just in front of Aubrey. Now, we've got the luck of having a small vehicle. We might be able to move around onto the little peninsula that's over here. And we're probably gonna be able to get a view from the other side, but it is going to take some maneuvering. But we should be with her. Wait, Aubrey's on. Let me just chat to Orbs quickly. Orbs, do you think it's better if I go to the other side of the Shkova? Aubrey says this is very, very, very thick. It's very difficult. But we're going to try. So while we try and maneuver to get another view of the Ngoma and her cub, so exciting. We're going to go to James, who's on foot.
I'm very pleased that Brent Leo Smith was smacked in the head there by a branch. I feel that's the universe telling him something, really. There is the exoskeleton of a little scorpion, and I suspect, as with the last one that I found, that this is an olive... What's it? Olive burrowing... Answer. A what? Olivencia, yes, but the common name, the olive burrowing scorpion, I think it's called. I'd never know, remember if it's the olive bark or olive burrowing scorpion, but there it is. Olive bark, says Jandre, the resident Aranidae expert. Okay, so olive bark it is, thank you, Jandre. He says, pleasure, and I'll hit him with my stick afterwards when we're off air again. And you can see there that he's quite a nasty little fellow. He's got a thick tail and very thin little pincers. And I know that we all often tell you about this, but the reason that it's important is that obviously the tail, therefore, is more important to him when he is killing things than are the little pathetic pincers on the front of his body. And I think it's absolutely astounding that the scorpion managed to climb out of this exoskeleton in one piece. How on earth did it manage to do that without tearing the whole thing apart? I don't know, is the answer. It came out where the mouth is, basically, and somehow managed to pull all eight legs. It's an arachnid, remember, so it's got eight legs. All eight legs out and the tail intact and leave this perfectly intact thing here. Now, what we don't want to do, of course, is sit on the adult version of what just made that. He's not alone over here. There are termites all over here. And these, if I'm not mistaken, are not fungus-growing termites, or certainly not the mound-building fungus-growing termites, and that's because I can't find a mound around here. But they will often forage about in a place like this and then take the dead wood. They sort of set up a temporary home here. And they eat away at the wood, and then they'll disappear again once the wood is finished. And if you look over here, you can see where they've eaten the wood. They've covered it up with soil, and underneath that soil, they've eaten away at the wood. And, John, if you look right where my stick is, you can see a freshly sort of excavated piece of the wood there. There they are. You see it there. They're just going into the hole there. I think that's rather remarkable. Now, one of the reasons they do this, they build this sandy thing, is to stay away from the sun. I'm slightly distracted, everybody, because Brent has found the cubs.
Well, a cub is a strong point. You can see movement behind a bush. Wait, there we go. So all three are suckling at the moment. Now, she has chosen a good spot to stop. There's lots of little hidey spots for the cubs if she leaves them. Thirsty little blighters. And I'm surveying the surrounding landscape, and there is a chance that I'm going to be able to maneuver to the other side of this deep hole. And if you have a look off the side here, it's a good 10 feet down to the bottom, but there's a little peninsula on the opposite side, and the cubs are actually in where they're, no, there. No, they're more to the right there, Dave. Dave's lost the lions now. There they are. Oh, look at that. Hello, monster. He's coming to inspect us. So what we're going to do is, I'm pretty sure it's going to take me about 5 or 6 minutes, but I can maneuver around next to them. Oh, you can hear them. I'm just going to keep very, very quiet for a second. You can just hear them, this little... They're growling at each other while they're suckling. Listen to that. Isn't that incredible? Very upset with each other. Guys, there's six teeth. No need for argument. Look at that. Wow. So upset with each other. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to try and get ourselves into a better position. Of course, as you can see, there's a fair amount of worry between us and the lions. And I'm just checking. I'm pretty sure I can get there. And hopefully we'll have a bit more of a gap. Cubs! So exciting! Oh, they're just too gorgeous for words. They are absolutely... I think the only way to describe these cubs is delectable. But while we try to get into a better position to view the delectable little monsters, let's go see what James is up to.
Delectable monsters, really? Okay. Jen B, I believe you've been very distracted by the dry and chapped skin on my lips, which we thought we'd give you a nice close-up of. There you go. Sorry about that, Jen. I think I need to put some stuff on my lippies, obviously. I do apologise. Right, now, come over here. Now, don't trip over this stuff, Chandra. This is the kind of thing you will fall over and stab yourself to death on. This is the sort of impenetrable forest of Strychnos madagascarensis. And I thought until very recently only the fruit was a useful thing at all, until Herbert told me, no, no, no. And this is one of the joys of walking with him. You can take the roots of this tree, the Strychnos madagascarensis, which is a not particularly unattractive tree, and if you've got a child with a birthmark, and you all know how disfiguring birthmark can be, if you've got a child with a birthmark, what you do is that you take the root, not the leaf, like this. I'm just showing you the venation on the leaf. Can you see it's got three veins from the base? That's how you know what it is. It's easily identifiable as Strychnos with those obvious three veins from the base there. You take the roots and you burn them up and you powder the ash, and then you mix them with either wild medlar roots or guari berry roots or white berry bush roots. Those are the three kinds of plants that you could use. And then you make little incisions over the birthmark and you rub that into the incisions, and apparently it heals really nicely. I'm not sure what kind of birthmarks exactly, some probably skin diseases or something like that that comes with being born, and the earliness of life. And that apparently is a very effective way of getting rid of those little ailments and lesions, and that's quite important, because otherwise it would be a tree I would think was almost worthless to this area. Now Shamsung, you want me to explain the difference between poisonous and venomous again? Well, yes, I can certainly do that. Poisonous means something that if you ingest, i.e. eat it, it's going to cause you to it's going to cause bad effects. It might kill you, it might just make you vomit a little bit. But venomous means something that will envenomate. In other words, that will create some kind of toxic effect in your body. And so to envenomate would be to introduce a toxin into the body. Let's just have a look here, Gendre, if you don't mind. It would be to introduce a toxin into the body through the into the blood or the nervous system, the endocrine system, and sort of poison the body from within. And that's different from eating something poisonous. So something that is venomous can envenomate. It can, something that is poisonous will poison you, but that's normally through ingestion. Now, can you see this track? Is it viewable? This is a white-tailed mongoose track, everyone. Now, the white-tailed mongoose is quite a special mongoose. It's the biggest mongoose that we get here, and that's a real snake eater. They will definitely eat snakes if they can get hold of them. It's probably the size, it's probably about that long. That's the same length as my stick, just about, which is about 1.5 feet. It's about the length of a white-tailed mongoose, excluding tail. So they are quite large mongoose. And they walk along, and the real indicator that this is a white-tailed mongoose is the fact that if you look very closely and very carefully, you can see out in front of the track are the four claw marks. They've got very, very long, sharp claws. Slightly blunter than a cat's at the end, but much longer. And blunter because they're out all the time. Unlike a cat's, of course, which are not out all the time. They are protractable. On we go, Andre. Brent is just trying to reposition so he can get another view of those little cubs, those delectable monsters. Ooh. Here is an extremely unusually large example of Strychnos madagascarensis. And this will make very nice fruit. So a tree this size, if the elephants don't get to it first, which I suspect they will make very nice fruit. It'll get very tall, not very tall, but as tall as that, and make a nice round crown, and it produces big green balls of fruit. And those green balls of fruit, when they're ripe, you can open up and you can eat the fruit straight. Don't eat the seeds, because they're full of strychnine, and that will result in being poisoned as opposed to envenomated. And that can... I don't think there's enough to kill you, but it certainly is not very good for you. But you can take the flesh and dry it and mix it with honey, and apparently it's delicious if you mix it with honey. I'm going to walk continuously at this angle, because if you could see how Gendre is walking now in order to make the shot that he's taking smooth and not trip over something, you would be that. Let me just show you what he was doing, everyone. This is important to know. This is the kind of thing that he has to do in order to make sure that you get a smooth picture and you don't trip over something. He's very professional, as I was wondering. Yeah, you just keep walking behind me like that. I'm having a thoroughly good time watching you. Okay, come on, don't be silly. Susan, you say, is it safe for me out here when Herbert disappears? Yes, it's safe for me even if Herbert wasn't here. And the only reason we have Herbert is because it means that I can then look you in the eye when I'm talking to you. I don't have to stare around all the time. I know where Herbert's gone. I can see his tracks on the road. I know he's going down there in order to try and find Karula's tracks. That's what we're hoping to find. So I'm just going to follow along the way he's gone. He's not far ahead. So I'm pretty sure that within this area here, there isn't anything that is likely to cause our demise. And, I mean, that doesn't mean I'm not aware of what's going on, but, yeah, it's completely safe. And it's always safe, you know. It's a big misnomer that being out here is a massively dangerous thing to do. It's not if you're aware. If you're unaware, then it can be dangerous. And we had quite an interesting incident yesterday where we all went for a run, and there were a few guests in camp, and two of them just took off, sort of went off in front, and that's dangerous because that's just not, you know, they're people that are unfamiliar with the area, and so it becomes quite difficult or becomes quite dangerous. As long as you're aware of what the threats are, it's pretty cool. Okay, the cubs, those delectable monsters, have been refound.
So we are with the delectable monsters, and Dave is in a bush, but it's worth it because of the little monsters. So we've managed to get to her, and unfortunately they're still in a thicket, but we are quite a bit closer. Now I'm just going to try roll forward. I reckon if I can get 10 centimeters further than where we are, we're going to get the best view. Of course, I'm quite worried about being stuck here because there's no real way out. Here we go. Look at that! Oh, eat it! That one seems to be the bravest because it actually started stalking us. We were trying to maneuver through the bush. A little effort. Look how tired. It's a tired kitty. So as I said, if you want to know how big these lion cubs are, they're about the same size as a domestic husky. Except even a cub this size, if you got into an argument with a domestic house cat, it would. Oh, it's just too gorgeous. Now, this is what I've seen. I, at the moment, I can't tell how many boys, how many girls. I think what we're looking at is a little boy. And that's purely based on behavior. Look at that. Oh, it's a tired kitty. Now, of course it's a boy because it's got its tongue half stuck out of its mouth while it goes to sleep. I'm pretty sure that's a little boy. I can't really tell the other two. Oh, here comes another one. So it's coming. It's coming. Oh, it's going to lie down. Go. Oh, they are just too wonderful. I'm so happy that I decided to leave Torchwood and decide Juma was the place to be. Oh, I'm going to chew a stick. So, of course, they are teething to a degree. They're going to lose their milk teeth quite quickly. And in the middle of a thicket drainage line, and I know we're going black screen, but should I move back a little bit, a bit higher?
Yep.
Okay, we're just going to try move back a couple of centimeters. See, now this is very important. You notice they reacted when I started the car, but I'm going to let the car run for a second. And here we go. You can see the naughty little monsters. Just try to go back a tiny bit. Move when I touch the branch. Ooh. I'm not sure whether you can okay, picture's back. There we go. Look at that. And I do apologize for the back being time these little guys. If you hear my camera clicking away, it's just because I can't help myself.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
I hope you didn't get my little gormless face there, everybody. Brent lost signal, I'm afraid. You're stuck with me again. Kirsten said, please find frame, so I went, which is a beautiful picture, and I hope you didn't see it. Screen grabs of my lovely face. We're walking down towards where the gauri repeater, and you can see it sitting over there, and what I'll just explain what that is quickly, and then we'll talk about some more biology. It's over there. It's a tower on which there are a number of important pieces of equipment that allow us to be able to send you a high definition signal from the middle of the African wilderness. And that goes, the signal goes from the camera into Jean-Ray's backpack. Hope I didn't break anything. Out of an aerial there, gets sent straight to there. That then bounces over to the final control, down into the final control, through a couple of computers like that. Then it goes up into a satellite dish and through the universe to London, and from London everywhere else. And that process takes approximately, apparently, I think there's a delay of less than 30 seconds. So from what I'm saying to you now to when you're receiving it everywhere else in the world, 20 seconds or so? Unbelievable. Anyway, that's how it works. Now, Brent has found some signal. Let's go back to the cubs.
So that's Mom there. And we do apologize, but she has chosen a wonderful spot for the cubs. But of course, that is not the best spot in the world for our signal. And as you can see, so two of the cubs are directly behind her, but the one is keeping a very close eye on us. And it's about half a meter closer than Mom is to us, giving us the lion's eye through the thicket. The other two look like they're suckling again, and unfortunately her back is to us, so that is the cub we can see at the moment. There we go, and just see that. Oh no, what are they up to back there? Not suckling, playing, wrestling with each other. Look, so glorious. Now, we're gonna stay here for a little bit, but I think we're probably gonna leave her. I'm pretty sure she's gonna be here. Oh, wait. No, going to snooze. Oh, I thought. Sorry, Dave. Back at the back. Now, James has apparently named these cubs Jerry, Louise, and Kirsty. And I think there's a male involved, so it's going to be a bit interesting. He's going to have. He's going to be confused. We probably could call the male Jerry, but. But Jerry is obviously Geraldine. Hello. Now that's the one I think is a little male. And you can see that little white in the corner of the eye. That's just dust buildup. Oh, I can't help myself. Clickety click 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 through the bushes. Well, hi Terry. Terry is in Oklahoma, and Terry would like to know, what is the probability of all three of these cubs and Karula's cubs surviving to maturity? Now, if you take the law of averages out in the bush, it's not very good, unfortunately. Leopard and lion cubs have about a 75% mortality rate until they reach a year old. So once they're a year old, well, with leopards, their mortality rate drops to almost sort of 10-12%. So it's very unlikely after they reach a year. But lion cubs, even after their year, lion cubs only reach that sort of stage when they're about 3 years old. And that's due to the fact of the male lion coalition takeovers, and that the fact that a male lion's reign at the top, the reign supreme, is a lot shorter than a male leopard's. So it's if we take it, the chances are more than likely, and I would love to be wrong on this, is that only one out of these three cubs is going to survive to maturity. Now, with the Birmingham boys being a big and strong coalition, it's possible that all three will survive, but over lions in general in this area, if we speak about mean averages, it's more than likely only one of the three will survive to maturity. Of course, I hope I'm decidedly wrong, but unfortunately, nature is a very harsh place. Now, Michael's posed a very, very interesting question. What would happen if the Birmingham boys found these cubs without the lioness? Would they know that they're theirs? Being where we are, which is sort of the core of the Birmingham's territory, they probably would. But the Birmingham's being first-time fathers, it's very difficult to say. But from what I've heard from the other guides and how they react with the Styx cubs, I think there wouldn't be a problem. So if they hadn't had interactions with other cubs, there is always the possibility they might eat them. And male lions are well-known for eating their own offspring, but it seems like the Birmingham's are not that type of male lion at the moment. So fortunately, I think it'll all be happy days. But you never know till it happens. That's the thing out here. I mean, what a way to come back from leave. I mean, in kahumas and male lion last night, and then I'm just absolutely ecstatic to be able to see these little delectable monsters. And Safari Dean's wondering, at what age does the male start outgrowing his siblings? Probably around now we might start noticing a slight difference, but in a month or so it'll be a very noticeable difference. Well, not very, but start getting taller in the shoulder. And from behavior, it's generally the best way to tell. Now, I'm by no means sure that it's one male and two females. I haven't actually been able to have a good enough look. And as you can see, we're right in the middle of a thicket. But just from behavior, and I said I might be wrong, from behavior it looks like one male. And the other two, maybe females, or maybe there's a shy male. So I can't say for certain what the sexes of the cubs are yet. But with her being on Juma, we've got a really good chance of being able to decipher that little conundrum, and hopefully we'll maybe even be able to decipher it on the sunset safari. Hello, Jennifer. And Jennifer is wondering about incest in lions, and will male cubs mate with their siblings? Males, given the chance, will mate with their mothers, believe it or not. And incest in big cats is actually not that uncommon. And with lions, they can inbreed for up to six generations without any medical defects or problems. But after that, it becomes a very big problem. You start getting stunted growth and very strange things like that. But in an open system like this, which we're open to like 8.5 million acres of Greater Kruger National Park and Transfrontier Park, that the genetics move around enough. So it's very uncommon for a male lion to stay for multiple generations. So normally, and if we look at the Matimbas, who used to be the dominant males in this area, when their current set of cubs with the Inkahumas, which is now the female who started mating, so she's just under 4 now. So male lion tenure sort of only lasts 4 or 5 years. And in very extreme cases, it goes longer than that. And in that way, it's how that they stop incest, that a new bunch of males sort of come in every, on average, it's not obviously not an exact science, every 4 years. And that sort of stops incest. But in rare cases, they do mate with their daughters. But it's not as big a problem with lions, and especially not in an open system like this. So it looks like the Inkahuma little family is going to sleep. And we're probably going to try find a way out of here shortly. We're just going to leave them be for a while. Mom's asleep and all three cubbies are asleep. Oh, Mom's just lifted her ears when I said she was asleep. And don't think we're going to see too much more movement here at the...
I think it's a little moth, to be honest, and I think what it's doing is eating or drinking the last little bits of nectar. What's... Chandra just went... What does that mean?
I was singing for you, Jeff.
Singing for me. Don't. So I think that's a moth, but it's very difficult to tell. It's very small, and I don't want to pull it out, but isn't it amazing? I just think that these incredible shots that we can get of these things, absolutely unbelievable. I think that's so special. Now let's just examine the rest of this plant, because it's one of the... I have shown you this Waltheria many times, but very few of them are in this condition this time of the year. So let's see if we can't find a crab spider perhaps, or a mantis disguised as a Waltheria flower. Certainly, if I was Stefan, I'm pretty sure I would have found many kinds of crab spiders on this thing by now.
There's a thread that just came off.
Is there? A thread?
Not a web.
A web. I don't think I'm that blind that I wouldn't have seen one there. Sorry about that, everybody. Apparently the stream went off for about a minute. What we're doing is investigating Waltheria flower. I'm not sure how... Did you get our moth, do you think, Kirsten? Do you think they saw our moth? It's very important. You did see our moth, thank goodness. Let's just quickly look down the rest of the length of this plant and see what other creatures are going to be on it. And because it's one of the last sort of bits of moisture around here, one would expect to find a few more interesting bits and pieces, but all there is that one lonely little moth. Chandra, do you know what it feels like to be a lonely little moth?
I do, James.
You do? Me too. This is the oddest bushwalk I've ever been on. I'm going to look at one more Waltheria flower, just simply because I think we're going to find some things on them. No, not on this one. We'll have a look at this grass instead. Now, this grass, I'm not entirely sure of the name of, but you can still see the seeds on it, right? You've got those seeds. And those seeds are a massively, massively important source of forage at this time of the year. Normally, there'd be a lot more of these sorts of grasses around holding these seeds. And for the little birds like the waxbills and the pytilias and the firefinches and the widow finches, they'd have these seeds to eat throughout the winter. But now, of course, because we had such a poor rainy season before this, very few of these grasses have actually got seeds on them. And so there's much less for everything to eat. Gendre is squatting at the most appalling angle, everybody. It really is. It's quite something to behold. It's very distracting. One just has to get used to him again once he's back from leave, you see. Just be quiet and keep walking. Here's an actual Waltheria flower, and it's the crab spider. If we ever actually manage to find one, I'll be so happy if I do. There's the flower, and the crab spiders that live on them disguise themselves almost exactly like that. So they look precisely like the flower, with a bit of the sort of old flower attached to them. I think it's really... Oh, there is one there. What's that? It's a flower, an old flower. I thought it was a spider. Damn. All right, let's not embarrass myself any further by looking at Waltheria flowers. Right, let's see what else we can find here. Now, many of you, of course, know that Jamie Patterson is an exceptional flautist. Not that any of you have heard her play the flute. But not a flute, but in also part of the woodwind section in the orchestra, is the clarinet. Now, this is actually an amazing thing to have found. Were you to want to make yourself a clarinet, this wood is fantastic. It's a zebra wood. It's called Dalbergia melanoxylon. It's really hard. And inside heartwood is the most stunning black colour. That's why it's called a zebra wood. But you don't normally find it in pieces this large, because the elephants destroy it. It's normally very, very small, scraggly, nasty sort of bush. And I wonder if in here we wouldn't find some nice heartwood. I think it's probably a bit hard. It's harder than leadwood, so to get into it is really difficult. But once you can get a piece of this stuff, you've got a clarinet for life. And if you look over here, you can see how it's been broken many times by the elephants. It's been eaten away, and even many times this season it's been eaten. But it has grown. It's done rather well, and you'd get a really beautiful piece of wood out of that, where you should come and chop it down, which we are obviously not going to do. Now, Miss. Right. Sorry, I missed your name there, Miss. I thought it was Miff. That's because Kirsten McLennan-Smith is from Durban and doesn't speak English. You say... Are there any baobab trees around here? Miss, there aren't any baobab trees. The southernmost baobab tree, or the biggest and most southern baobab tree, that was Gendre walking into a tree, is found about 70 kilometres north of here on a farm called Giraffe Farm, which is in the Timbavati, which is also a collection of private nature reserves like the Sabi Sand in which we find ourselves now. And there are two big baobabs there. There's one in Hoedspruit, which is just to the west of that position, and then not much until you go up further north. Around Palaboa, there are plenty of them. In the Olifants Valley, the valley of the Olifants River, you'll find a few baobab trees. And then once you get north of the Letaba River, which is kind of, I'd say it's probably, Herbert's found something. It's probably... What was I going to say? It's probably about sort of two-thirds of the way up the Kruger Park. Then you get hundreds of them. And if you ever want to see scenery, wildlife... Sean, let's stop falling over. Scenery, wildlife, and unbelievable baobab trees. Mapungubwe is the place to go. That's the northern parts of the Kruger National Park. It's absolutely stunning. Sorry, not Kruger... Pafuri. I mean, northern parts of the Kruger National Park. There you get baobabs all over the place. These huge canyons. It really is quite stunning. We're going across to Brent. I don't know what he's got. What's he got? elephants. Let's go and have a look.
So it seems like it's just a morning full of babies. And we've got a tiny little guy up ahead. We're just going to edge a little bit closer. Now, I know James was talking about baobab trees, and of course these elephants, unfortunately for them, have never experienced the joy of a baobab tree. But in other parts of Africa, baobabs make a very important part of an elephant's dry season diet. Now, a baobab tree, unlike a lot of the trees we get here, doesn't have sort of the same system to transport nutrients up to the rest of the tree. So elephants can actually completely debark the whole of the baobab tree and then be able to still, the tree can keep growing. Hello, Mom. Oh, look how sweet it is. Smelling us. Look, he or she, I can't see just yet. I thought he was giving us a sniff. Now it's found something to play with. Now, this little guy's young, very young. It hasn't mastered the art of the trunk yet. He's got a very particular forehead, this little elephant. See, old before its time. Wrinkly forehead. So he had a wrinkly bottom. We haven't seen, or probably got harder to see as it's got older, but now we've got a wrinkly forehead. And if we look at that, it's very distinct. It looks very wrinkly for a little one, and it's also got quite a bit of hair on its head. But from a wrinkly forehead to a far better looking, not better looking, a far more streamlined creature with James.
It's quite a tenuous connection, but yes, there in the background, everybody, is an African hawk eagle. Stunning eagle, probably about a foot and a half tall, maybe, no, 2 feet. 2 feet tall, and probably a wingspan of about 6 feet, so substantially smaller than something like a martial eagle. And normally, they're in pairs. And what that hawk eagle will be doing is sitting on the branches, looking around to see if it can find a ground bird, or maybe a lizard or something like that, or a rodent, but ideally a Franklin or a guinea fowl is what it will want to eat. And normally they'll hunt in pairs, like I say, and one of them will sit in an obvious position like that. The other may well be slightly more hidden in another tree down below, perhaps. And what that one will do is distract whatever it is they want to eat, and maybe even fly up off while the other one comes in from behind. Takes the Franklin or the guinea fowl from behind, grabs it, and then they will feed on it together. And that's quite a nice sort of arrangement, I think, they have. Right, let's go back to the baby elephant with Brent.
So we've snuck a little bit closer. And look at that. Look how cute it is. It's smelling us. It's trying to decide whether we are more interesting or having a drink is more important. I can't see. I think it's a little boy. I can't really see properly yet. Absolutely adorable. So at the moment, it's testing us out. It's seeing how brave it wants to be. It's making sure it's got Mom's leg between us and him or her. I can't, as I said, I can't really see yet. But I think if we sit here for a little bit, it's going to become a little bit more brave. Hello, Ma. Yeah. It's okay. It's a little boy. It is a little boy. And it's a very wrinkly little boy. It doesn't only have a wrinkly bottom, it's got a wrinkly body. Now, speaking about this very wrinkly little one, Wesley is wondering, is there any particular reason why elephants have wrinkles? Now, It's just because of the way their skin is, Wes. And it's got, they've got very baggy and thick skin. So that's what causes the wrinkles. Now, of course, like with everything, each individual elephant has got a different set of wrinkles. Now, you might find that this little one is particularly wrinkly because it's been born in a drought. I mean, this is no, now that we're closer looking, this is no older than 3 or 4 weeks. So it could have been born with more wrinkles because of mom being a little bit stressed for food. But if I look at mom, and she's actually okay, and I think it just might be like wrinkly bottom, it just might be a wrinkly elephant. But very distinct sort of forehead wrinkles on that one. Now mom seems to be favouring grivia bushes, so raisin bushes, this is a wild raisin bush, and she's literally moved from one raisin bush to another. Look how her ear is at the moment, it's being pushed like that by the branch. Almost looks like she's growing a horn, but it's not, it's just that the cartilage in her ear is being pushed by the branch while she's feeding. It does look quite strange though, doesn't it? Dave thinks it's funny. I can hear him giggling. Now, grivia is actually quite important trees for elephants in times of drought. And in times of feast, so big rains and that, they very seldom feed off grivias, but we'll notice elephants eating a lot of different species at the moment. She's actually also eating a sour plum. So she's not only feeding off a grivia, she's also feeding off a little sour plum there. And normally the elephants will only feed off the fruits of the sour plum, but at the moment they'll feed off the whole sour plum. Hi Felicity, from the land of the long white cloud, New Zealand. And Felicity is wondering, is an elephant's spatial awareness, does it play a part in knowing where the little ones are? So I'm just going to move the vehicle a little bit. And Mom and what are we going to call this little guy? I think wrinkly forehead's a bit lame. I think maybe we should call him old before his time. But it is a little boy. So Felicity, and with elephants and calves, the females are very, very aware where the calves are, and you get a lot of touching, and of course listening is probably a massive part to play. And when they're this young, they very seldom move more than a few meters from their mom. As they get a little bit older, and specifically with a boy, they're going to get a bit more brave and thirsty. And they'll wander a bit further from mom, but they will always be in contact. And just remember, a lot of elephant contact calls and noises are well below what we can hear. So these, we only hear the sort of deep rumbles. But they speak in much lower tones that we can't even hear. And they can, research has found playing those rumbles, and elephants have reacted up to about 20 kilometers away. I don't think they can hear much beyond 20 kilometers. There are some very fanciful theories by certain people thinking that elephants pass on messages to other elephants and they can communicate for hundreds of kilometers. I'm afraid I personally don't believe that. And of course, you're more than welcome to your own beliefs. And I've spent the majority of my life with elephants, and I don't see that happening. Now, they've moved into a bit of a thicket. I'm just going to reverse a little bit. There are quite a few other ellies around, so we're actually amongst quite a big herd at the moment. Now, Michael's wondering, where is this elephant herd? Well, Michael, we're probably about 500 meters from where we left the lions. So we're on Central Road, and we're about halfway between the junction with Drakensberg and Inyala Road, north and south. And I got so excited this morning, I forgot my tea. So now I'm having my tea with the elephants. I think there's actually someone's Twitter handle or whatnot is called High Tea with Elephants. So this is morning tea. Well, obviously, high tea is in the afternoon, but I'm having my morning tea with elephants. Hello. Is that lovely little female here? Now, it's amazing the size variation in elephants, and particularly with females. So even though she looks quite young, I would say she's not. I'd say she's an adult, and I would actually say she's pregnant. Now, the reason I say she's pregnant, oh, there's my hand, there it is. You can see the bulge sticking out of her belly, but now that's not uncommon at this time of the year. And elephants have astronomical amounts of gas. But what makes me think she's pregnant, Dave, if we zoom in on her teats or her breasts, now they're starting to swell, and unfortunately wait for her to move her leg. Now, the reason I think she's pregnant is that her teats are starting to swell, and also the fact is that more than likely if she had a current baby, there would be little suckle marks on it. So I think just the way her stomach's sitting, the fact that her breasts are starting to swell, she's very pregnant. Wow. Justin, you have stumped me completely. How much milk can a female elephant produce in a lifetime? I have no idea, to be honest. A baby elephant probably drinks, on average a day, about 10 to 15 liters of milk. And the female probably produces surplus of that. And, okay, let's try work this. Dave, how's your maths?
Not great.
Okay, I'm going to have to bring up the iPad for this. Now, Justin, you must realize this is complete guesswork at the moment. So I'm going to say, where's a calculator? I need a calculator. On average, where did I put a calculator? I tried to reorganize my iPad recently, and it is now, I'm just going to search. I think that's easier. I can't find a calculator. You can find everything but utilities. No, it's not there. Oh dear. Okay, well let's try this. Do this manually, which is going to be very tough. So let's call it 20 liters to make a nice round number a day. While they have a baby, they suckle for about 4 years. So 365 times 20, Dave. maybe the ladies in final control can help me out here. So 365 times 20. So 7,300 liters a year. Now, in final control, can we times that by 4 years? It sometimes suckle a bit longer, but let's do 4 years. 7,300 times by four, probably close to 30,000 liters per baby, and the average elephant will have, let's call it five, let's keep it nice, easy numbers. So 30,000 times five, three times five is 25, no? 15, sorry, that's how bad I am at maths. So we can say rounded off, and we can go a couple of thousand liters either way, is about 150,000 liters in a lifetime. Now, of course, this is complete speculation. So, I a lot of guesswork happening here. But the ellies are moving off into a thicket. So, I'm going to do the same, except I'm not going to move off into a thicket. I'm going to move down the nice road. And we're going to see what else we can find out here. So, sorry, I just... Now, I've heard of lots of different things being up people's noses, but never this before. So let's go see what James has managed to fit up his nose.
I don't know what he's talking about. I wouldn't put something like this up my nose. I mean, goodness gracious, that would be ridiculous. This, everybody, is that exotic snail that Steph and Jamie found a little while back on Jamie's very first walk. They found the snail, and it's called a banded snail. And you can see the black band there. And apparently there's quite a lot of worry because it is, although, I mean, you would imagine that an exotic snail isn't a fairly innocuous thing, apparently it is eating all sorts of other snails out here and taking over areas that local snails would use. Where it comes from, I don't know, but that is the banded snail. And normally, this one's been eaten, thankfully, but normally they make a cap. They create a sort of cap over the top there, and that's how they, and then they'll go dormant for the winter, and that's how they sort of stay hydrated during the course of the winter. They make a sealant over the top, in the same way that one of those giant land snails, which many of you will know, make a sandy cap over the foot to keep themselves hydrated during the dry times. On we go. Ah, yes. Right, I'll tell you our plan at the moment. We're coming up down through here, and this is, we're now north of, I'm just going to give you a little bit of perspective as to where we are. Okay, here's, I'm going to draw Juma for you quickly. Justin, you want to know what the oldest tree in this area is? I don't know. Certainly, the oldest tree in South Africa is many thousands of years old and it will probably be a baobab like we were talking about. That's Juma, idea of Juma. We started over there, where my stick is now pointing. Okay, the elephants were over there. That's where we viewed them. We walked south, down towards the western fringes here, up the western boundary. We've gone past where the elephants were, and we're going to what we call Sandy Patch, which is around here, and we're still hoping to pick up Karula's tracks, and we'll gently make our way back down as the morning goes along. So that's the sort of lap that we're doing at the moment. Brent, well, who knows where Brent is? Does Brent know? Come, let's go see what we can find. We're walking through the block here, hoping to see, well, some tracks of Karula maybe, but also just a mammal or two. We found very few mammals, and I think that's got a lot to do with the fact that the weather has become inclement again. It isn't quite as clear as it was when we woke up this morning. Now, look down here. Roger, very nice question from you, which I shall explain to you now. This is a Sisyphus tree, or buffalo thorn, and I'm going to repeat another story that Herbert told me on Sunday afternoon, because I think some of you wouldn't have been with us on Sunday afternoon. Right, there you are, Sisyphus mucronata. Chandra likes it if I hold it in front of my face. Apparently it looks very arty. See? Now, what you do is, I've told you many stories about the Sisyphus, the most common being that it's used to go and fetch the spirit of your dead ancestor if they've died somewhere close to home, and or somewhere far away from home. And one of the great things that Herbert told me about this the other day was that even if someone dies away from home, you go off and you take a piece of this tree from the home, you go to the place where they died, and you collect their spirit into this tree, and then you take it home again. And I've told you before that you have to buy a taxi ticket or a train ticket, and you put the branch next to you, and you treat this as though it's the person, your dead ancestor or your dead relative. You treat it exactly as if it's them. And Herbert told me that you take it actually a level further than that. If you buy a meal, if you buy a Coke, if you buy some water, or a sweet or chocolate or something like that for yourself during the long journey, then you have to buy one for your dead relative whose spirit is inside this Sisyphus tree, which I just think is amazing. And so if you ever come to South Africa, I imagine if you travel in the rural areas away from the sort of, not the tourist traps, but if you travel away from on your own, if you drive through Africa or use public transport, I suspect that you'll find people traveling with little branches like this, buying seemingly pointless Coca-Colas and chocolates, wondering why on earth they would have bought two of everything that they've bought, which I think is a lovely story. So that is Sisyphus mucronata. Okay, let's continue. I see Herbert over there. He's off in the direction in which I am now walking. I was going to point with my stick, but it was stuck under my arm. Come on, Jandre. Bring those great big dumbbells you have attached to the bottom of your knees. Herbert looks like he's found something. So while we go and discover what that is, let's go and find out what Brent has discovered.
Well, I haven't discovered anything apart from the fact that I'm so happy to be back here, and the bush just seems to be giving. I mean, the Nkuma cubs, that baby elephant, and Aqua, you're a genius, by the way, Aqua. Aqua has come up with a perfect name for that wrinkly, four-headed elephant, and I think we shall now call him Benjamin Button, or Benji for short. But now I have heard via the ether that goes into my ear that there is something on Cheetah Plains. Now, what is something? So I'm going to start moving towards Cheetah Plains, and while I do that, I've got a quiz for you to consider. Now, James was talking about the baobab tree, and if you've ever traveled in Africa or Madagascar, strangely enough, or even Australia has baobabs from when the continents were together. There's all baobabs share one thing in common, whether they be in Madagascar or Australia or Africa, they are pollinated by one species. One species. So it can be different types of the same species, but I wonder if anyone out there knows what animal pollinates baobabs. And if you know, let me know by sending an email to questions@wildearth.tv, or if you are a tweeter, use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. What animal pollinates baobabs? And second part of the question, in Africa, what specific species, now not the general species, what specific species of animal pollinates baobabs? And when do they do it? That's for bonus marks. So if you get the first part, all wonderful. And if you get the second part, I don't know how. What should we do? We should give a noddy badge. Yes. And we'll give you a noddy badge. So we'll nod. I'll make David nod on camera as well. So I'm about to dip into a black signal area on my way to Cheetah Plains, and I'm sure James has got something to entertain you with. If he doesn't, he's just quite entertaining himself. So let's go see what Commander Bond's up to.
No, don't turn your screen over. Nothing's happened. I am hanging in what is known as negative geotaxia. I'm being negatively geotaxic as we speak. That's why I sound a bit nasal. But I'm doing this because there's a spider that I can see. Jean, can you see the spider? There it is. There's a spider. Ooh, that was a horrible rush of blood to my head. Now, what spider this is, I don't know. It looks like a sort of, as Jandre said, a common wall spider. If I was to say to you it's a common wall spider, and I said it with sufficient authority, you'd believe me. I don't think that's what it's called. But it is one of those very flat spiders that lives underneath the bark of a tree like this, in amongst the scorpions and things. And I sat on this log prior to hanging my head in a negatively geotaxic fashion, and Herbert said to me, "Utalu shpamu shtagluma." Shpamu is a scorpion, and shtagluma means it's going to bite you. So he's obviously concerned that there are scorpions in this log, and that they will bite me on the bottom, or anywhere really. And if you look over here, Jandre, you can see here where it lives. That's where the spider lives, which I think is absolutely incredible. Somehow, that spider folds itself into that amazing little silk tunnel. And Joey, in Australia, you want to know if spiders shed their skins in the same way that scorpions do? Absolutely they do. And you find them in the same way that you find scorpion exoskeletons, almost entirely whole. And the best example I ever had, Steph found a piece of bark, and underneath it he found a living violin spider, and next to it five or six different instars, or stages of development that the spider had gone through and crawled out of its skin. And there were five or six different exoskeletons there, as well as the living violin spider, which will give you a nasty puck if you get in its way. Right, let's continue. Brent is seemingly hairing off to what sounds like a very exciting sighting. So that's very good. In the meantime, we'll have a look at these thorns. Now, these thorns, for those of you who are old enough to remember the gramophone, these used to be used actually as gramophone needles when you, say, you came out to this area from ye olde England and you wanted to listen to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony recorded on those sort of barrel things that they used to do them on, or your old 98 records. You could use one of these if your needle from somewhere in London was broken. Apparently very effective. And what I was hoping to find was a slender ant living inside one of these needles, but these ones are all very much intact. So we're not going to find them, I don't think, probably because of the season. But Jandri, if you come around this side, you will see a tropical tent web spider's nest. Oh, sorry. There. Just all over here. Most incredible web. I never get tired of looking at these things. I don't know if you can even see it, can you, Jandri? Mm. It's so very fine. Like gossamer. Don't you think, Jandri? Do you know what gossamer is? Mm-hmm. Nor do I. But I imagine this is what it's like. I think this is like gossamer, everybody. Could somebody please explain to me what gossamer is? Because I'm pretty sure that's what it is, but I don't know for sure. Okay. No, there are no slender ants living in here. All right, that's the tropical tent web spider and its gossamer nest. Oh, Jenna, you want to know my worst injury being out in the bushes? I think it was probably this one here, Jenna. You see? I kicked a zebra wood stump. It was very sore. Jenna, I have never been severely injured out here. Touch wood. I haven't been severely injured in the bush, thankfully. I've pulled a hamstring playing touch rugby out here, but other than that, I haven't had a severe injury. Jandre has had thousands, of course. He has stood on a nail that drove all the way through the top of his foot. He has dropped a high lift jack on his foot, both of which resulted in some poor hapless sod, me in one case, Connor in the other, having to take him off to the doctor because he was unable to drive himself. Let's watch your aerial here, Jandre. But, you know, I don't hear of... Jandre, get out of this thing. Do it yourself. I don't hear of dreadful injuries out here unless... I mean, it's... If something hits you, I mean, if you get hit by a buffalo or you get hit by an elephant or something like that, then obviously you're going to be very badly injured indeed. But otherwise, no. Scraps and scrapes from tripping on branches, standing in a hole and maybe straining a muscle here or there, but really nothing that dastardly at all. Leo Smith very nearly hurt himself. Okay, we're going to need to reboot our pack, so let's go back across to Brent and I'll tell you about this dung shortly. We need to reboot the pack, Andre.
Welcome back. As you can see, Dangerous Dave and I are racing through the northern section of Cheetah Plains to what could possibly be an incredibly spectacular. And of course, I'm not going to tell you what it is. That would be too easy. But we are approaching. We're still about 5 to 10 minutes out. Of course, we might hit a roadblock or traffic jam. And a traffic jam in this part of the world. Major traffic jams would be buffalo and elephant. Minor traffic jams would be impala and kudu. But so far, the road is open. I've checked my traffic app and there's nothing impeding us from racing there as fast as possible. And I just can't get over how good it is to be back. I do love being on Game Drive. And I'm very, very lucky that I am able to, one of the few people in the world who can do what they love. I think that's the same for most of the Safari Live crew. And James is back, and the next time you see me, hopefully I'll be with I'm not going to tell you. Let's go see what James has got.
We're back, everybody, and the picture is seemingly okay. Now, if I'm not mistaken, this is dika dung, which is a wonderful way to alliterate something, dika dung, and very similar to impala dung, except it's just smaller. And that, of course, is genre because the bottom of a dika is smaller than the bottom of an impala.
Thank you.
Yes. Now, a dika, which can be very difficult to see, actually, the microscope would be the best thing to use here. Hang on a second, I'm trying to break it apart. Now, I don't know if you're able to see it in there, but a dika actually eats largely leaves. Now, if you were to compare this with steenbok dung, steenbok would be largely grass, and it's, I don't know if you're even able to tell the difference there, but there are little tiny pieces of browsed leaf in there. And they're ruminated, obviously. The animal has swallowed them, and then re-chewed them, and then absorbed just about all the water possible. And the other day somebody said to me, what's the difference, what's the sort of, I think it was James Richards, said, what's the ecological difference between a dika and a steenbok? And the difference is that a dika is water dependent. They need water to survive properly, and a steenbok doesn't. A steenbok is almost completely water independent, which means a steenbok is able to eat grass and that sort of thing, which have less maintain moisture for a shorter period than do the leaves and branches. I'm going to try and walk Jandra into a strychnos bush. I missed. He was too wily for me. Okay, we're walking down this path here. There we go. Aruz in Florida, thank you. You say gossamer is something delicate, light or flimsy. Well, it's exactly what that tropical tent web spider's nest was. Now look down here, you can see a pathway, and I love these paths. It's a path made by animals, obviously, going to and from the water, going to and from probably the Galago Pan, and it's on this path that Herbert suspects that Karula perhaps came, and that's why we're walking along here. So let's go and see if we aren't very lucky to pick up the tracks of our favourite female leopard. And Lucy, you want to know how heavy the pack on Gendre's back is. Lucy, my answer to that would be not heavy enough. Frankly, I think the more weight we put on him, the better. But Gendre, what does it weigh? About 8 kilos? 10 kilos?
Depends
how many batteries it has. What does it weigh now?
I think about 20 pounds.
About 20 pounds. Okay, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it's uncomfortable, because it was, I mean, the actual pack it's designed on was designed, I think, probably in 1934. And the discomfort, I don't think, is so much the pack. It's the holding the camera and moving that around and, you know, to get the pictures that Gendre does, he really does. I mean, I know I take the mickey out of him non-stop, but to get the steady pictures that he gets, it really is quite astonishing to see the ways in which he has to contort himself. Right, while we talk about that sort of thing and consider the contortions of Gendre Gerding, Brent Leo Smith has got a very nice surprise for you.
This is more than a nice surprise. This is behavior you don't see often. Now, that is quarantine. And if you listen really carefully, you can hear a low growl. Now, that is quarantine. And about 40 meters away is Tingana. And they are growling at each other. Now, I find this quite strange that Tingana hasn't tried to sort out young quarantine. Well, maybe he has, and we're witnessing the aftermath. But there's heavy growling going on. Now, we can see it's not a Mvula, just because of his back. Now, Mvula has a landing strip that sort of goes up his tail. His spots are very symmetrical from his tail up his back. And listen to that. That's Tingana growling. So, he's showing a bit of almost sort of indifference to quarantine. I mean, he's got his back to him. Now, I doubt he would do that with an adult male. And quarantine is growling back, but not quite to the same timbre. Now, the reason Tingana might be so tolerant, I mean, this is right at the edge of his range. Now, heads up. Oh, there's zebra just behind him. Yeah, look up a bit. There we go. There's zebra walking towards a three-in-a-row pan on cheetah plans. Now, that's a bit big, unless there's a baby for the leopards. Oh, quick, the side. He's just stood up. Oh, look at that. Isn't that a fantastic shot? If he looks back at us with that buffalo skull. Now, it's going to be interesting to see whether he decides, now that Tingana's not watching him, to slink away. Look at that, isn't that beautiful? I hope you guys are getting screenshots. Remember to share them with us on our Facebook page, Safari Live, or pop them on any of the many Facebook groups that our fans have. And if we look carefully there, you can see that the soil attached to his jowls, his bottom jaw there. And that's from growling, and he's been salivating a lot. So when he's laid down, the sand is stuck to him. Now, we've seen this with Karula and Shadow before, that they salivate a lot when they're arguing. Oh, my goodness. Isn't that... I know, everything's happening. Out of nowhere, this beetle bounced off my face and landed on my finger. I'm not quite sure what type of beetle it is. Sorry, forget the beetle. The growling is going on. He just lifted his head. Now, I'm sure you guys can identify. I'm not 100% that it's Tingana yet. It's definitely not Imvula. I'm trying to have a look. It does look like Tingana, but we are quite far away. I was wondering if it could be Ximbalana, but I think it is Tingana. Oh, quarantine's trying to sneak away. So he's taken the opportunity. Tingana is focused on the zebra. So he's trying to sneak away. Sorry, I've just got to be on the game drive for a second. Sean. Okay, guys. Ooh. Watch quarantine. Now, just to the left of him, walking up the road right towards him. And you can see his behavior. He's sneaking around to some zebra. Now, the zebra have spotted him. Now, unless there's a foal there, the zebra are quite safe. Now, if there's an aggressive stallion, look at quarantine, he's scent marking. Cheeky little devil. He scent marks, then looks back to see if Tingana's reacted, which he hasn't. Yeah, the zebra snort. The zebra snorting on either side. So the zebra in front of quarantine and the zebra behind Tingana. Oof, he's being very cheeky. See, he's now given himself a little bit more distance. Now he's growling back. Well, Terry's wondering if quarantine and Tingana aren't brothers. They're not related, in fact. As far as I know, but his brother has been causing, well, Quarantine's brother is Kunyuma, who has been causing a lot of havoc down to the south around the Sand River. It's all going on here. Sorry guys, I just need to be on the radio. If it sounded like Sean was trying to get hold of you. Okay, so the reason I'm sitting so far away is I want to see what happens, what pans out between these two leopards. So the zebra have spotted and have snorted and they've actually moved away. Yeah, there's actually a foal. That's even a big foal for leopards. So this is really interesting what's happening here. Now, as I said, I think Tingana, if this had been on Juma, would be far more aggressive and far more active in chasing him. But because it's right on the edge of his home range, he's not. Let's go have a closer look at Mr. Tingana. And I just want to confirm that it is Tingana. I'm pretty sure it's not Mvula, looking at the ears. How's that, Dave?
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. Now, hopefully he looks at us so we can actually see. But looking at the ears, we can actually hear the growling a little bit because we're a bit closer. He stopped growling now. I'm not sure that's Tingana. I'm sure I have it. I think this could be Ximbalana. I'm just going to quickly check his spot pattern. And I'm going to check it with one of my pick. I don't think this is Tingana. I'm not 100% sure. Guys, if you know which leopard this is, please let me know. But I don't think, now that I'm closer, I don't think it's Tingana. And that would make a lot more sense with the behavior. I do not think Tingana would tolerate quarantine to this degree. I think it might be Ximbalana. And if it is Ximbalana, that's a new leopard for me. Let's have a look. Let's see, I've got a picture here. Now I need a picture of Mr. Tingana. I'm not sure I have one on my iPad. There's... Oh, you can hear that growling. Yeah, I don't think it's Tingana. I think this could be Ximbalana. If that case, it's a brand new leopard. How exciting! I'm just trying to double check. I don't have all the photos I take on my iPad, but I thought I had one of Tingana at least. It must be one of Tingana here somewhere. And so it sounds like our leopard experts out there think this is Ximbalana. So in that case, they are brothers from different litters. I'm just trying to see. I don't think it's Tingana at all. Hear all the zebras snorting. Well, thanks, Ellen. Ellen Fowler agrees it's not Tingana, it's Ximbalana. Now that makes a lot more sense. And it's a new leopard for me, isn't that amazing? But I know he's one of Karula's offspring, but how old is Ximbalana? If you guys know, I think he, just looking at him, he's probably about 6. But if you know his exact age, please let me know. Now, quarantine must be four-ish now. But as far as I know, Ximbalana is the dominant male in this area. Tingana does come around the Chila Plains camp, but we're quite far to the east from there. Oh, look at that, he's a nice big scar on his nose. So it looks like he's got a 3-2 spot pattern. Can you guys hear that? Can you hear it, Dave?
Yeah.
That low growl. Yes, no, he's definitely not the same size as Tingana. And when he sits up like that, look at the size of his neck. I mean, you can see he's a big male, but he's definitely not 8-9 years old, which I think Tingana is. So exciting! So, these are my first pictures ever of Ximbalana. Okay, now he's sitting up. I'm just going to move the vehicle a little bit. Okay, so while we reposition, let's go to James, who's atop a Termit Terrier.
Tremendously exciting, everybody. Not so much where I'm standing, although we were asked about severe injury earlier, and this could result in my first severe injury out here. Incredible to have those two leopards there. And Herbie was just telling me that Ximbalana means an emerald spotted wood dove. I've never seen that leopard. I'm extremely jealous that you're seeing him now. Fascinating. And if I'm not mistaken, possibly a full brother to Quarantine, is that correct, from a previous litter? As far as I remember, that's probably what that is, but I might be totally wrong, so if I am, please let me know. What we found here, apart from a termite mound to stand on, just while Brent repositions himself so that he can re-show you those leopards, was the spot. You know, you always wonder, where do the tortoises go? In the same way that you wonder, where do the flowers go? Have a look here. This, just inside here, if you can believe it, and I didn't find this, Herbert found it, obviously, is a Speke's hinged tortoise. It's living inside the termite mound because it's air-conditioned. In other words, it's well-insulated, so the temperature's relatively consistent, and it won't dry out too much. There'll be a bit of moisture in there, and there it will be aestivating. So not quite hibernating, which is a total shutdown of the metabolism because of cold. It'll be aestivating in there because there's no water around. Now soon, if I was to sort of spray this area outside the mound with water, that thing would eventually wake up, especially when it became warm during the middle of the day, come out, bask in the sun, have a drink, and probably go back inside. And somebody asked a little earlier, at what temperature do the snakes come out? They'll come out when it's warm, in the middle of the day, and sometimes in the evenings when it's been a hot winter's day, because we do have those here. So Roger, you were wondering about that, and they come out onto the roads, and they bask where the heat is sort of radiating off the roads. They quite like to do that. So it can be at any time. It's quite chilly today, and I don't think it's going to get very warm. Apparently the maximum about 23 degrees Celsius. They might come out in that, but it's unlikely. All right, on we go. We're still continuing our quest to see if we can find Karula's tracks, because as Gendre very correctly pointed out to me, he said, we're likely to get a view through the bushes. They've got two with Brent in a vehicle. So go take a look at that.
So we're much closer now and we can see it's definitely not Tingana. And thanks to Ellen Fowler and many who identified him for me, because I've never seen this leopard before. Oh, looks like my guesswork was quite good. He was born in 2010, and thanks to everyone who sent that information in. So he's 6 years old. So I said he doesn't look like a 9-year-old leopard. He's not as big yet. So even though he's an adult, he's fully grown, He's still going to fill out quite a bit. Now, he's still growling away. He's very full, nice fat belly. And then, here comes Aubrey. He's been looking at quarantine. I think we're going to go across to quarantine shortly and see what he's up to. He's doing very, very similar behavior to what Ximbalana is doing at a distance. I'm just going to have a quick chat to Orbs. It's not Tingana, Mfo. Ximbalana. Yeah. He's too much bimpan to be Tingana. Oh, look at that. See that little tail? Oh, sorry, I was watching the leopard, not there. He started flicking his tail, which is a sign of aggression. And that's not at us. That is at quarantine. Okay, so we're gonna leave Ximbalana. Let's go have a look what Mr. Q's up to. Of course, we're not leaving him totally. We're just going 60 meters away where Mr. Quarantine is lying. Doing very similar behavior to here, which he's quite cheeky, Mr. Quarantine, for a just over 4-year-old male. But as I said, his brother is causing waves down around the Sand River, and apparently he beat up an adult male called the Airstrip Male recently. Now, of course, I don't know if this is 100% true. This is just what I've heard via the via. Now, Quarantine's brother, Kunuma, here we are. Hello, Mr. Q. Nice to see you too. Although he's not paying us any attention at the moment, he's deeply death staring Ximbalana. And he's also growling, so we've got the same soundtrack here. And you can see he's a bit younger. You can see he's smaller in the neck. And he's not growling quite as deeply. Sort of a little nervous growl. So we've got two of Karula's offspring. Now, the first time we saw Inkanyeni and her cubs on Safari Live, she was running. And she was running from quarantine, and there's a possibility that one of her cubs has been killed. And the most likely culprit, we are looking at him right now. So, Ximbalana was seen mating with Inkanyeni, so there's a strong possibility that he could be the father of those cubs. But since quarantine's been in this area, he is probably the most likely culprit if one of her cubs have been killed. And she has run from him a couple of times that I've heard of since we've got to Cheetah Plains Travis to the north of us on Inkoral. And about 70% of leopard cub mortalities are from other male leopards. And a male like quarantine is sort of the normal sort of culprit to that. So he's a dispersal male. But the way he's behaving at the moment, it looks like he's trying to set up territory here around Cheetah Plains, but he is a little bit young. And normally 5-6 years old, but attitude's everything. So it could be the fact that his attitude, so not always the biggest animals hold the best territories. It's generally the most aggressive with the cats. What? Have we got movement? Sorry, no, I'm just trying to see if the other leopard's moving. I can't see. I think he's moving. Let me just change position quickly. I can't see him anymore. He could be on the move. So sorry about sticking my head in your frame there, but I was trying to see what was going on behind me. And yes, he has moved. He's come closer. I'm just going to put ourselves in a position where we can, if there happens to be a chase, we'll be in the right spot. So So we've got Mr. Quarantine just to the right here, and now if we follow my hand. Oh, I can't go that far. There. There he comes. Oh, now this is going to be interesting. Now, this is going to be very interesting. How is Quarantine going to react? Is he going to stand up to the challenge, or is he going to skedaddle? Look at that. Oh, Mr. Q is taking his cue. But he's trying not to move too fast. He's like, I'm not actually moving away from you. I just felt like getting up. And there's Mr. Ximbalana. Now he's got a full belly, and Quarantine's got an empty belly. Okay, this just come wide, Dev. So Quarantine's scent marking, and just stay a bit wider, because if he goes, okay, that's good. So Ximbalana's about 30 meters away now. So if he runs, which he might do, let's come maybe even a little bit wider there, Dev. So he's on the edge of the road right there, and it's just try to keep them both, because what I think is going to happen is Ximbalana is going to try to get himself into a position where he can charge. It's just not wide enough. There we go. We've got, here we go. We can see both of them now in shot. I'll try to keep my fat head out of the way. See, Quarantine's being quite clever. He's like, well, I'm walking away, but I'm not actually. But he's doing the same as a lot of animals. He's taking an oblique approach. So he's walking alongside, but actually extending further away. There we go. You can see him just disappearing edge of frame. So he's managed to put himself, he's managed to put himself in a safe position. So it's too far for Ximbalana to charge. Sorry guys, just going to be on the game drive radio for a second. Standing by, Mike. Only two. No problem. So now we've got decisions to make. So what also Mr. Quarantine is doing is he's putting a river system between himself and the other male. But he's still showing a bit of cheek. So I think if Tingana had been here, Mr. Quarantine would be sprinting for the opposite direction. He wouldn't be behaving like this. Okay, so we're going to go back to Ximbalana and see what he's up to. And now Aubrey's going to go towards Mr. Quarantine. I'm going to try to see if we can get just behind Ximbalana and we can actually see both of them in the same shot. So Quarantine in his oblique, I actually don't care walk, managed to add another 30 meters. So Ximbalana got to a stage where he's almost close enough to charge. And that's where I was getting Dave to stay wide. Now, a little bit further forward. Oh, there we go, now we can see. So there's Ximbalana in Quarantine's under those two trees there. Of course, he has scent marks behind the bush. Now, quite often, a lot of male leopard fights, and I use fights with inverted commas, are like this: scent marking and growling over a decent space that they don't actually have to physically attack each other. Now, when they do, it is very, very violent. Female leopards are actually more prone to fighting than males. males like to almost play a similar game to the Nyala, who's the biggest and prettiest. And of course there's serious problem if they injure each other. So that's why male leopard fights, obviously. And I remember last year with Scott, we had Tingana and Anderson doing very similar behavior to this, growling, scent marking. I just remember being very jealous that I wasn't there. Okay. So what Shivamba Lion's trying to do is he's trying to get closer to quarantine, and quarantine keeps keeping the gap. So while we just try to get ourselves in a good position again, let's go see how James is faring on Shank's pony.
Some buffalo in here, everyone, and they ran away from us because they heard us coming. And it's always a great reminder when you're walking through here, you lose concentration. And we were kind of just chatting, and then the buffalo exploded out of the bushes, not too close, but we're just really through here now, keeping an eye out. And what I'm going to show you is what we're kind of looking out for. So there's Herbert there, and Herbie's walking a little bit in front of us because of the pack and the sort of equipment we're carrying. We're not as quiet as we might be. So if you're walking through the bush like this, what you'll be looking for is any kind of dark shape. And I'm just trying to see what we did see earlier on. If you look, Jandre, over the top of that termite mound there, you see the termite mound? Over the top there's a dark stump. The other side. Now, a buffalo lying down in the bushes does not look dissimilar to that stump. And so that's what we're looking out for. And so constantly we're walking along going, nothing. Okay, let's carry on. Let's go and find out what he saw. The wind is not good for us. It's blowing straight towards the direction that we're walking. Now, I suspect all that happened there was that Herbert heard something, but has now decided that it's not a threat, whatever it was. Come in. Okay, we've got some impala alarm calling. We're just going to quickly show you these caterpillars, just to show you that we're not completely messing around out here. These look like the, I don't know what kind of caterpillars those are. They look almost like processionary worms, but they're not quite. And I know that these are very beautiful, and that you would like to view them for the rest of the day, and that it will be very regretful to you, but we have to hand you straight back to the leopards, because they are still a magnificent view. So go and enjoy them.
So we've moved around, and we're directly behind quarantine, and if we look up and zoom now, Dave, there he is. There's Ximbalana. Now, both leopards are trying to play it cool, but you can see who's more dominant here as we zoom out, just judged on the way they're lying. So Ximbalana's lying open belly, showing that, and if we look at quarantine, ears are down. He's trying to sort of pretend he's relaxed, but he's not. Now, Safari Hay is wondering which one is bigger. Ximbalana is bigger. So the leopard furthest from us at the moment, Quarantine is, there we go, that's Ximbalana. He's 6 years old. Quarantine's about four. Now, Ximbalana is the dominant male in this part of cheetah plains. And as I said, he hasn't been dominant for too long, and that probably explains his behavior. So if it had been a big male, sort of 8-9 years old, like Anderson or Tingana, it would be very, very, very different. I don't think they would go through the growling and standoff with a male of 4 years old. They would literally just charge and chase him. Hi, Mareka. Mareka is wondering, why is this leopard's name Quarantine? So after he became independent of his mother, he used to spend a lot of time on the quarantine clearings at Juma. So that's where he got his name from. He used to hang around on quarantine and around the camp. Yes, you. What has he heard behind? Oh, it's more zebras. Now, these leopard standoffs can sometimes last days. I've seen one between two big male leopards go on for about 3 days. It all depends who gets hungry first, and I think in this case it's going to be Quarantine. He's quite empty in the belly, while Ximbalana's quite full in the belly, so he's got the sustenance to wait out the standoff. Hello, Mr. Q. Now, hasn't it just been the most phenomenal sunrise safari in Kahuma and Cubs, Quarantine and Ximbalana, which is a new leopard for me. I know a few of you might have seen him before, but since we've started this current section of Safari Live, I think it's a new leopard for Safari Live. Quarantine taking his opportunity to gain a bit of distance between the two again. Oh, it's time for a little scent mark. See, he scent marks, then looks back to see what the other one's going to do. Very brave and very big, Mr. Q. So if they actually had to have a tussle, I think Ximbalana will have the upper hand with that 2 years more of growth. While we sit here to see what pans out between two of Karula's princes, let's go see what James has got on foot.
We heard two impala alarm calling. Remember I told you, everybody, and they weren't alarm calling. What they're doing is they're rutting still, completely wasting their time. There are two males there, and unfortunately they've just moved behind a bush. They were out in the open quite nicely for us. Jean-Dri, come up here this way. And they've seen us, but they're so consumed with fighting with each other that they don't really seem to care. So let's just walk a little bit up here. Now, many of you, of course, and I'm sure you've been asking Brent about this, are wondering what would happen if Quarantine came across George and Charlotte. Well, I mean, I think you're getting your answers now, just with slightly older versions. There's the one male. They're not quite having a proper rut, but they're just sort of alarming at each other. They may have smelt a predator as well, and that may have set them off, but I think they're probably just alarming at each other. Now they're alarming at us. Remember I said the wind was wrong? They may well have picked us up. This is awesome. This is a fantastic sighting. That's definitely an alarm call, but it could well be at us. I've just got a nod from Herbert saying, yes, that's probably correct. Which makes me feel tremendous. I feel like I've been patted on the back. What we're going to do is we're just going to do a little circle around this area and see if we don't come up with something. Because that's not a typical rutting sort of sound. So let's do a little loop around here and see if we don't come up with something. We haven't found one track of Krula. She was around here yesterday. I'm just going to walk like Jean Bessard and fall over anything. She was around here yesterday and we haven't seen any tracks of her this morning. And so who knows? We're a bit confused as to where she's put her babies. There were reports of her going into Hoffman's yesterday. I'm unconvinced that those were her tracks. I think that sounds much more like it was Shadow, and especially as they crossed over a main road, you wouldn't have seen them accurately. It would have been impossible. Anyway, let's just go down here. This is where we first saw the Impala. This is where they first started shouting from, and they were having a bit of a fight around here. So we'll just eye the ground, we'll eye in the trees. But that wind, remember I showed you the way the wind was blowing, was coming straight this way. They may have picked up our scent, they may have picked up the leopard scent. They may have picked up a lion scent. They may just be idiots and fighting with each other over ladies. In which case, there will be no tracks of lions or leopards here. Alright, while we have a look, let's go and see those real live leopards with Brent.
And there we go. As James said, real live leopards. If you've just stumbled upon us, can you believe you're seeing this at the same time as me? We're on a live African safari. And we're with two male leopards who are brothers, believe it or not, from different litters. There's the second one. And they're busy having a little territorial argument. Now, I'm listening to the Game Drive radio. Ephraim's exact words is, quarantine. He's tatama chance. He's taking chances. And at his age, he is definitely taking chances. Scent marking and standing off with a male 2 years older than him. But as I was saying, a lot of being a dominant predator out in the African savannah is all about attitude. So sometimes the smaller individuals are dominant over big individuals. And it's quite obvious in lions, the most aggressive is the most dominant. Now this little standoff has probably been going on for some hours already, and it's probably going to continue on for some hours. Now, Ximbalana, a male on that side of us, Anna Marie's just let me know she had a sister called Shivinzi, who's completely disappeared. So no idea what happened to Shivinzi. She might have moved into the Manuleti, you never know. But this is the first time I've seen two of Akrula's previous offspring together. And there isn't too much brotherly love being shared. Now, Ximbalana is actually the name of a feathered creature. So let's go to James, who's got Ximbalana, the feathered one.
Yes, it most certainly doesn't mean feathered one. I'm not sure why it's called Ximbalana, because it's one of the unusual names that doesn't seem to be onomatopoeic. In other words, not named for the call. That is the emerald spotted wood dove, and it goes and Herbert just told me a wonderful expression in Shangaan, and that is Sharila Ximbalana, which means you are really hungry, right? Okay. I'll explain this to you. The mournful call means my mother is dead, my father is dead, everyone is dead, 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 dead. That's what the call means. That's why you say Sharile Shivambalan. You're crying like an emerald spotted wood dove. Isn't that awesome? Most of the birds, like I've said, Mantengu, Shveve, the drongo and the lilac-breasted rhoda, they're named for their onomatopoeic sound that they make. This one, not so much. But just sitting there, this is the most amazing sighting of an emerald-spotted wood dove on foot. He's only about 10 meters from us. Looks like it might be a youngster. But obviously doesn't like the cold weather. And so very neatly tucking his little beak under the wing there. You know why they do that, of course.
Hi guys, sorry, I'm just on the game drive radio. You caught me in an inopportune moment. I'll be back, you know, firm Ximbalana in quarantine. Now there seems to be a little bit of a lull in the growling. Now, it's in these quiet moments where, there you can see, Quarantine's trying to watch the others. I think he's trying to think, is there space to put a little bit more distance? But as Quarantine lifted his head, so did Ximbalana. Oh, big yawn. And there we go. The growling has started again from Ximbalana. Oh. Growling at your little brother is tiring. Now, when domestic cats fight, they make a very disconcerting screaming noise and racket. And Sarah's wondering, do big cats or leopards make that same noise when they fight? They don't. The main difference is that the hyoid bone, which is in the throat and the vocal box of cats. Now, in domestic cats, the hyoid bone is solid. And in leopards and lions and other big cats, the hyoid bone is cartilaginous, so it's able to move, and so they can't make very high-pitched noises. So it is a deep bellowing growl. I think the best way to describe leopards, very deep, noisy. So if you've heard leopards mate before, if you've been watching for a while, it's a very, very similar sound, obviously just a little bit more intense. Now, Quarantine looks, he's looking back, Ximbalana. I think he's seen another animal. It's probably more zebras. Oh, Ximbalana is up. There's some scent marking. As James Richard is correct, it says it's not a true leopard standoff till one of them blows a bubble. And the reason for that is, a while ago we had a standoff between Karula and her daughter shadow, and Karula, while growling at her daughter, managed to blow the most perfect large spit bubble. Deborah, the armchair traveller, is wondering what would happen if Karula came wandering through now without her cubs. Well, it all different than mine. I've got a bit of camera in me. The chances of Karula coming through are very slim. This is well out of her territory. The only reason she would come here is if the cubs got killed and she was looking to mate. Now, strange enough, she would probably mate with her son. Ximbalana, I think quarantine's still a bit young, but she would, and it's inbreeding happens in big cats, and it happens more often than we think. But generally, this is why young male leopards move away from their natal territory. It's an instinctive response to try and curb inbreeding. We've seen quite a bit of scent marking today, and Justin's wondering, why do they scrape their back feet while scent marking? So the reason for that is it turns over the soil, and there's a slight bit of dampness in the soil, and it enables the urine or scent mark to the smell to last a little bit longer than it would if they just urinated on the open surface. They've also got glands on their back feet that they're scraping to leave a scent. Well, as I said, I think this little standoff is going to go on for the majority of the day. But isn't that fantastic? What a morning. Lion cubs, two male leopards, not just one. So there have been some different answers to the baobab quiz we started earlier. Mongoose, African killer bees. Now, just quickly on the subject of African killer bees, is that every single honeybee in Africa is what you would classify as an African killer bee. So it's our normal honeybee out here, but they are not. Safari Dean was spot on. It is fruit bats that pollinate, buffalo, that pollinate baobab trees. There we go. There's a look at that. There we go. There's another one. So they're probably on their way to three in a row plan to spend the day mulching around in the mud. And you can see quarantine see them as well. Yeah, so you're going to go stalk buffalo. I think they're a bit out of your... I do love this leopard. A bit out of your size range, but... And it is not a breeding herd of buffalo. There's no babies. It is definitely just two big old bulls. So around 300-row pan at the moment, there's a massive animals. I mean, there's zebra behind us, there's buffalo in front of us, there's two leopard right here. Look at that. And he's going to say hello to William on the tracker seat. Oh, is it William? Yes, it is William. Say, hello, William. There we go, William's waving. There we go, big smile from William. Who's Aubrey's tracker. There we go. Here's William in quarantine. So I'm not sure what quarantine's up to at the moment. I think he's just going to have a closer look at the buffalo. actually hear the buffalo rubbing their horns against the bush. Oh, he's actually going closer to Ximbalana at the moment in expecting those buffalo. And Ximbalana has just got up. We don't have a good view of him, so let's just stay with quarantine there, Dave. Sorry. Ximbalana's moving through a thicket. If I think something's going to happen, I will inform you. So here we go. So Dave's with quarantine. I want to keep my eyes on Ximbalana. Now, this is quite interesting because they're both moving towards the buffalo, who's oblivious to their presence at the moment. You just.
So while this is happening, I think what we'll do is we're just going to extend for a little bit after drive to just see what's happening. So we're going to extend the drive for a short while at least, because I think these buffalo bulls, once they see the leopards, might chase them. So we're going to be. Look, there we go, the buffalo's after the leopard. He just gave the leopard a warning charge, he ran and stopped. So they don't even know there's another leopard directly behind them. So there we go, there comes Ximbalana. And there's the buffalo. Now, he knows he's much faster than the buffalo, and the buffalo sort of know that they're no real challenge. There we go, watch. Now, that puts him in very close contact to quarantine. Just hold on. Oh, he's going after the leopards properly again. The leopards have run, they're both on the same side of the drainage line now. So just hang on. Right, there's quarantine. Quarantine's run away. Now Ximbalana is following him. There you go. Stopped for a scent mark. Now they're about 30 meters. Ximbalana probably needs to be another 10 to 15 meters closer before he's going to charge. So the buffalo is actually sort of sped up the process. Now quarantine's scent marking. And Ximbalana's lying down again. we're just gonna hang around for a little bit longer. I just wanna see what Mr. Q does. If he keeps walking south, I think. Well, we can see who's dominant already in this scenario, and it's definitely Ximbalana. Yeah, Mr. Q is putting space again. So I think what's going to happen for the majority of the day is what we've been witnessing, growling, getting up, walking, scent marking. I just want to have a look for an extra minute to see what happens. If I feel there's going to be some action, we will extend. You can see it's not that normal little flick of a leopard's tail, and it's going side to side quite impressive. Okay, so Ximbalana's up and walking towards quarantine, so we are going to extend. I'm just going to see what pans out here. Ah, Mr. Q is not beating a hasty retreat, but he is retreating. But this is definitely hotting up, so to speak. I think the buffalo have caused it to sort of heat up, and they've definitely expedited the situation. But let's just watch what happens. So whether we're going to go on much longer all depends on Mr. Ximbalana, who we're looking at now, depending on what his next move is. He's walking, we're staying. So if he's on the move, we're staying. Quarantine is now moving further away. So now it's almost like neither of them want to lose face. Well, in Quarantine's case, he doesn't want to run away. But he's hungry, he wants to move away, but Ximbalana's going to keep shadowing him. And you might find sometime during the day, you might take the chance, if Ximbalana's snoozing, to run away, or slink away is probably a better word.
lost sight of Ximbalana. So for Safari Dean, spot on. These leopards are about as aggressive as a nyala. And they really don't like to physically fight unless they really have to. And there he is. And you can see this bout of growling and whatnot has caused a little bit more excitement, as you can see the saliva when he turns his head back towards us. Come on, mister. Actually, he's got drool hanging from his lower jaw. There we go. Now, the distance between the two leopards is closing. It's about 30 meters. And so we've got Ximbalana right here, and Quarantine's just over there. Let's go off to the side here. Sure, we've got, there we go, we've got both. Ximbalana has lain down, and Quarantine is continuing to move away. Well, thanks to the buffalo for speeding up the process. The only thing is, I hope they don't move too far south. Mala Mala is not too far from here. But well, I think we're going to, Quarantine's lying down as well, and so is Mr. Ximbalana. I think they're going to stop for a bit of a respite, a bit of a standoff. So from myself and Dangerous Dave, mm-hmm. It's been an absolutely spectacular morning, and I'm really happy we got to share it from you. But stay tuned, because we'll be back in a few short hours for the Sunset Safari. So toodles for now.